Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to give you some light entertainment the next 45 minutes. I recognize that it is preaching to the converted, so maybe most of it you already know. But it can be come in handy when you have to explain technical things to non-technical people. Very often the geeks and the nerds don't understand that not everybody knows what you know. And what's very logical is for most of the people around you absolute gobbledygook. So you have to invent stories and simple things to explain to ministers and get money, etc., or bankers. Okay, Arjen and I helped a little bit to bring down the Soviet Union. Helped. We didn't do that ourselves, but it was very instrumental, but I'm not going into that right now. He was such a nerd then that he started to correct me halfway each sentence I was trying to say. He was already correcting me, so of course he knows better, but sometimes I can better explain it to non-technicians. Okay, there we go. One of the themes of this conference is interconnection. And you run into that very fast if you have programmed something fantastic, a little gadget, and you have suddenly to connect it and it won't connect, or they have different assumptions or language or meanings on the other side of the fence. And that is a continuous story. I started work in a large chemical company, Akzo Nobel, and everybody bought there the most fancy computers for measuring equipment, etc. And it was said to management, it's purely standalone. And after about a month, they said, Jaap, by the way, can you connect it to all the other computers? I said, yeah, you said it was standalone. Nothing is standalone anymore, nothing. Everything around you is interconnected, even the light sources and things, cars. It is everything is either there's computers in them, or I will skip this, or you can read that later. Either there's computers in them, or they have to talk to each other to do something together. So this talk is about swarming, about how things are going to behave when you connect massive amounts of people or systems or people and systems. It can behave in quite different ways than we would expect. Now, this is a snapshot from our beach this summer. Most of the children were sitting on the beach all day with their smartphone or their iPad, and it even etched on their bellies that they had been doing this. They do it all day, and you can say we allocate a certain time to our children that they will be online, forget it. They want to be online all day and chat and do things. There are now 6.5 billion people having cell phones, not all of them smartphones, on this planet. And we are only about 3 billion internet connections. So that we have way to go. And this creates thing. If so many people talk together, there's bound to be some effect. Yeah? And everybody thinks it's a neutral thing, but it's like handing Kalashnikovs to kindergarten children, you know. They know what to do with a Kalashnikov, and they know what to do with a smartphone. There's a kindergarten school in the Netherlands which has a gigabit connection. They need that. And what are the little children doing? We have no clue, and the teachers have no clue. But they know what to do, yeah? So, okay. We don't have to explain to them. They already know what's going to happen and what they want. But we are the obstacle they have to to overcome, probably. This is a Dutch chart, and you can read it, of course, very easy. It charts what happens in 60 seconds each day. Each 60 seconds a day, there are about 347 billion, million, no, 1,000 tweets, sorry. I'm just waking up. 38 million mails, etc., etc. It's huge. It is not somebody WhatsApping or watching video, or it is really amazing what they do. And the amount, the size, the growth, the scale of it is baffling. And fortunately, we have an infrastructure which can handle scaling up. It was put in, the engineering guidelines for that have been kept very strongly in the hands of the engineers until now. And it is amazing how much it can handle. But no, not very many people know that what's behind the screen, literally, you know. They think, yeah, something with Wi-Fi, and then a provider, and then maybe backbone operators. And we asked parliamentarians in the Netherlands, what happens if you send a text? What happens? Where does it go? Can you give any idea? And they didn't have no clue. They thought it goes by the airwaves to London or New York, or they have no clue what's behind the screens. And that's a problem for us, because if they don't know, they won't allocate any funds or get people to work to maintain it or prevent or safeguard it or whatever, or listen in, etc., etc. Now, so I have a little bit this picture. Everybody, maybe even in this room, thinks maybe I don't know everything, but the others will know everything. Well, everybody has the same idea that they don't know really what's going on. It's so amazing, surprising, baffling. Every day there's unexpected things happening. And, well, I try to give some more depth to what is really happening. Now, I was involved in the startup of Eduroam, the Amsterdam exchange, internet exchange, which is one of the biggest in the world and grows, is growing very fast. LTE for students, that was an idea for me. The fourth generation mobile phones. Because we have a little bit of a problem. Students have no money. And the telcos are not very eager to sell them time on their network. And they have a great demand for online working. So, and the telcos also complain that if there's 5% or 10% of the population who is ruining all networks because they have so much bandwidth need. Yeah, these nasty students. Yeah? So I said, well, we will do the following. You should put some base stations on the university premises and make a separate LTE network for the students. Then we kind of get that traffic out of your system. Yeah, yeah. And then put it on the backbone of ServNet, which is about 100 gigabits backbone lines like RNet. So we help the telcos, right? Well, kind of. And they have no money, which I have never seen a student who has enough money. So this is a solution for both sides, and they are very happy with it. And also the low-far telescope, but I will not go into that. Okay, first, for your general knowledge, disruptive innovations. Sounds terrible. And a lot of industries are trembling because they have vested interest in keeping you on the left line, which is sustained information, selling you a better product in the same line for less money and more performance. So you keep buying their stuff, mini computers and servers. They get more small and more powerful, and you the same clients keep buying that. That's fantastic. But suddenly some young people come up with a solution which is absolutely more efficient and cheaper, and which you most of it you can do yourself. And that's the key. It can be lousy performing at first, maybe it's rubbish, but it's going to be improved very, very fast. It grows very fast, it grows exponential, it's viral, people show each other, and you don't have to ask permission to anybody to do it. Yeah? Do it yourself. So that is why a lot of technology in the internet and the IT sphere are spreading like fantastic. And at some point, the people on the left say there was no demand for that and nobody wanted that, it's too cheap and we don't get money from it enough. The vested interests are nervous. Yes, this is a completely new client group who couldn't afford it at first. Only these pioneers hate the pioneers for the next wave. There's some boy or girl of 12 years old and they put an Arduino or a Raspberry Pi or 3D printer or connect it together and gets it working, it's great. And the pioneers of a year ago, they say, ooh, shit. Now we have invested so much effort in what we, and somebody else is coming to disrupt us, yeah? So I met a lot of guys who thought they had it made, and suddenly the next wave came. So this is a continuous activity, goes on and on. Now the more formal thing you have to know is, this is a chart made by Professor Carlota Perez, professor at University College in London. She has written a book in 2006 and 7, and she charted about 12 golden ages we had in society from I don't know how long back in history. And she puts them over each other, and she found this pattern, a growth curve, a learning curve, which is an enormous boost for wealth and the economy and prosperity. And everybody is very enthusiastic. So this, the good news is we are in this such a golden age. The best of things are still to come. Yeah, that's nice to know that. So keep working, it's going to be better and better. But the bad news is, halfway, there's a sudden crash. The last crash was in the 30s, when everybody, you had the roaring 20s, industry was booming, the Great Gatsby, people got enormously rich, filthy rich, like now the 1%, bubble-like things. And suddenly, it grinded to a halt. Totally unexpected, they thought, well, now, it's... What happens? Well, what happens is that the golden age of the before this is now finally really coming to an end. It takes about two of these four stages, which are not shown, to really suddenly stop. We see, you don't maybe have seen this very strongly in Australia, or lots of unemployment and economic crash, financial crash. But in Europe and in America it has been severe. In the south of Europe, about half of the population is unemployed. Even young boys and girls who have a very high education get there's no jobs for them. So they get desperate. And especially people in office jobs who thought they were very safe are thrown out by the tens of thousands. Companies grind to a certain halt. The industrial age based on chemical, electromagnetic, and electromagnetic general technology is coming to an age, an end. It doesn't disappear, but it's no longer the growth area, no longer the things where new things happen. And, well, still in Parliament they think about big companies and manufacturing and factories and things like that. Fantastic. And even it has gone to China, a lot of that work, and the Chinese are now outsourcing it to Africa, because they also think there's less expensive workers. Well, that is not a solution. The good thing is, suddenly, very small, innovative groups make an enormous breakthrough. They really burst into life and kind of eat up everything, these disruptive things. And people say, yeah, those companies are only 20 people or 100. Is that all? No, you have to look at the doubling time. If it doubles in every 2 or 3 months, then it's an explosion, yeah? It is exponential growth, is having a fixed doubling time. And if you add, if you multiply by 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, it grows up like fantastic. Now, the good news is we are in for a further golden age. And the good news for you is it is completely based on ICT. ICT is built into everything. That is the basic technology. You may say, well, what about these Mercedes cars? It's electromechanical. Electromechanical. But even the people from Mercedes consider their cars as a flock of about 120 CPUs flying in formation over the highway. Yeah? So they see that as groups of computers. Yeah? We see that as an iron box with wheels, but it's all software inside and real-time things, etc. I don't have to explain to you. And it has to be top quality to do that. So, we are in for... For to get out of this slump, that's one of the messages. Carlota Perez found that a lot of things have to be changed. It's not our governments say, well, after some dips, now that we have the triple dip, or even the fourth dip is maybe coming up, then things will just go on like it was before. No. Some things will never come back. They are gone forever. So it is in their idea, it's just discontinuity, and then everything will go on as even the types of governments or nation states or all kinds of things have to really drastically change. Now, and she gave a list. I will not repeat what she wrote down, but it is in the handout of everything. The organization structures much more flat without hierarchies. Managers. Do we need this boss of Dilbert everywhere? Yeah? You know how terrible that is, that you have a boss who has no clue what you do and is still ruining all your efforts to do something useful. Well, a lot of those have to go to the eternal golfing courses, and they are just an obstacle. They do nothing, and even the bankers. We have now found out what tricks they did in Wall Street and in the city in London, etc. And it's really criminal. It is really a disaster. They used fiber optics to get things done just 1 or 2 milliseconds before the client, and then the price goes up, front running. in milliseconds. People have been measuring the length of fiber optic cables on the Schiphol airport because they knew that if only half of a millisecond faster the competition, then they have can put in orders earlier. It makes an enormous difference. So they have this flash activity from banks. It's really getting out of hand. And when they make such enormous amount of money, billions of dollars, there's no value added of them. They have done nothing for the clients or for the population or for the economy. They only have robbed us of so much money. And even their clients are pissed off. So this whole banking industry, now they have resumed nearly everything. We haven't seen any bankers in jail in Europe. Probably won't see that. We call them banksters because, yeah, they are. You can show that they are criminals. They are too big to fail. We say they may be too big to jail. Yeah? Okay. Now, this list, and there are two more lists I will also not discuss. But a lot of things have to be reorganized, redefined, changed, and maybe with new people, like a lot of governments. Like for instance, the Indonesian government is now consisting of very young people who know about computers and have taken a lot of measures against this old hierarchy of corrupt people who were in charge before them. And good news, ICT network technology is the key, the basic technology on which everything will happen. So that's you, right? And it makes young people, even geeks, suddenly very appealing to ladies. Yeah, I should also have drawn a girl geek. There are girl geeks, where boys are. Yeah, they are going to make a lot of money. At present, your salary is much too low, of course, but sooner or later they'll find out that you are a valuable resource. Yeah, they won't admit it. But next time you negotiate about your salary, maybe you can let them feel that, yeah, you can go elsewhere, huh? Okay, back to internet. There's a very simple schematic of what happened in internet. First, the worldwide internet, a network of networks with interconnection of a number of things. And BGP addressing, etc. Then it went over to corporate networks and local area networks and servers and systems. Then into the home, where it's now, in all kinds of places and all kinds of systems. Yesterday Richard told us about it. And the next stage is around our body. We will have a kind of internet with the same kind of architectures. There's an open network where a lot of things can be attached, which make use of this highway around your body. You may say, well, it's not true. Well, Arjen told yesterday what he did with the Arduino when he was asleep. Rather peculiar, but okay. And I still don't know what the measurement said, but and watches are coming up which are connected to other things. We will see a lot of stuff around our body, and the next stage, of course, is inside our body. I wouldn't like that, maybe, but maybe when it becomes available, I want a heart measurement or anything else, or showing lack of beer or something, I don't know. So the same kind of structure or interconnectivity and rules and protocols applies in a larger and larger, a smaller and smaller area in larger and larger amounts of devices. And that is what is shown here. Well, the 90s, it was PCs. Then, now it is smartphones. And the next phase, next explosion will be the Internet of Things, which is still unstable, and a lot of suppliers want to get hold of this structure and offer it. But it's going to be 28 billion devices around 2020. And that is a huge, and they are going to talk to each other and discuss, shall we put a light on or shall we put a light off? And hopefully it will not fluctuate what their decision, but they discuss it, it's kind of collective intelligence will form, like an anthill. An anthill is a very strange place. Ants have only 8 ways of communicating, 8 chemical smells. And they build air conditioning, they build humidity control, they design escape routes, they can respond to disturbances. It is like as if it's an organization which is bigger than its components. Humans have still problem to organize in such a way. Now, second thing which is very good to know is if you ask any technical person what's going to be happening with internet, they say faster, more storage, more powerful processors. So it's more. But people say, well, what's new? Is that what's really so important about that? Isn't it fast enough? Yeah? No. Something different is happening. If you have a fiber optic infrastructure, it really doesn't matter where you put devices. The latency will probably have a problem. If you connect to a cloud provider in the United States and you have things here, you have about 100 milliseconds latency. So you have to think about how to do that. It's not as if it's on your desk. And it's the light speed. Sorry, we cannot not do anything about light speed. We can maybe do things in parallel and have more than one fiber optic and then get a little bit more fast, but that's a physical constraint. So what happened then? What we see happening on the smartphone, most of the functions of the telco are now present. The telephone exchanges, they are gone. They are disintermediated. With Skype, the phone switch is here, and some kind of list about addresses is over there. So telcos are not very amused. They see their core business vanishing. They say we will become a commodity. Okay, I say, well, what's wrong with a commodity? It's not a scarce resource anymore, but you can still make a lot of money from commodities like the oil companies do. So you need a different business plan. But you are disintermediated. Microsoft, our sponsors, thank you for this conference, found out suddenly that the servers are removed, are put in data centers. They are not vanished, they are just cards now. But a couple of years ago, everybody had on the floor about 20 servers for the people there. And they had to be maintained, blah, 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 a lot of work. And they are now, Apple and others created a vacuum. Yeah, it's very clever for your competition to get a vacuum where your competition is. And a lot of other things, like banks, are they an obstacle or do they any useful work? I mean, then we can do it ourselves. airlines. A lot of airlines are now suddenly in turmoil because the pilots get less attention as they had. They were the people who flew the planes, which are heroes. And well, it's now bus in the air. And an airline is now a reservation system. That's the core business. That's what we see. We buy a ticket, we get the boarding pass, all kinds of things and extra things we don't want. We want to put you to buy insurance and all kinds of extras. But that's the primary business. Flying is becoming peripheral activity. Sorry to say, but a lot of other companies are taken inside out. What their internal administrative system was is now the outside skin with which you have contact. And so internet has a huge effect on doing business, on universities. You can watch lessons online. It's also a marketing trick to attract smart people from all over the world. And going to one place to be educated, like a university is, well, it has to be rethought what's going to happen here, for instance. It is not just putting some computers in and putting some lessons online. No, the whole damn structure is going to change. Okay, now I had a lot of examples. Like Airbnb, Uber, the taxi business. Yeah, people offer each other their car or drive people around for money. How are they going to stop that? We have a lot of stuff we want to share with others. And you can buy everything my children buy. They first go to marketplace, which is a kind of eBay, and see what the price is there. And then they go to a shop and say, this is what it costs on the internet. Yeah, what are we going to do here? Yeah, do I have to drive to a shop to buy something, or do you go down with your price? Yeah, and they are not amused. So, internet has an enormous effect, and very clever people can imagine that people want only one song from a CD instead of the whole CD. Or only one piece of the film, or they want to combine things into new art, which is now legal in Europe, to embed knowledge in new works of art. Well, so the copyright mafia is trying to resist that, but there's no stopping that, because knowledge and art is not a scarce resource. They want to keep it scarce. Well, they say, yes, for the authors, we collect all this money. Well, let them start to pay authors for their stuff instead of being only the collector of the money. So, disruptions all around. New business models, new possibilities. TV is going to be also split into smaller things, you can see. Now, what will happen in a little bit longer range is the trias internetica. It's rather formal, you have to stand up and salute to it. It was the the separation of state powers of Montesquieu was the separation of powers between making laws, law enforcement, and judges. And I'm sorry to say that, especially in the United States, they have thought this is a rather inefficient process. If you have a policeman, you can better make him a judge, and then you jail him, and it's ready. Well, we say maybe first, a judge should judge that case. You shouldn't combine those functions. That is so inefficient, you know. Well, it took us hundreds of years to establish that separation. the trias itself is the functions of the state, the functions of enterprises who take risks and make money when they succeed, and what most people have forgotten, the civil society, the civilians. And they are now organizing themselves. They are volunteers, most of them. They do things for others without being asked or being pressed to. They don't do it for money. They like to get things done together. And that is where all kinds of new structures are forming. So in political terms, a lot of discussion was, should the state do everything? Or now they say, no, let's make it a commercial activity, hospitals, they think it should be a commercial activity. It's much more efficient. Well, it's not. And then they go back to, maybe the state should do things like education. Yes, that's true. But they forget that there's a third pole, and that's the civil society. And that is where peer-to-peer communities appear, all kinds of corporations, all kinds of societies like yours do learn together, and they are, it's not about money or position in the government. That is something which has to be established. So it is equality, freedom, and brotherhood, the slogan of the French Revolution. And every task we should assign which of the three places it belongs. And if it's assigned well, and not many errors are made where things belong, then these three poles can help each other to create an enormous amount of wealth and synthesis. That's what I think will happen in the rest of the Golden Age. Now, one of the things which are in that civil society or nearly civil society is how people organize with developing products. It was a private good where people guarded their own knowledge, which was secret and nobody should know how they did it. And they found out after a while that it may be better to do it in an open source environment, share things, learn together much faster and much more high quality than it could be done in-house. Yes, you have to tell everybody what you're doing, well, maybe nearly everything, and it's much faster and better. And old managers, they are panic. They say, we give away our knowledge. They're going to copy it. Yeah, of course. Fantastic. And everybody's going to do what we do, and then we don't make any money anymore. Well, the answer to the, I know John Seely Brown, who helped to set up Silicon Valley, his answer was, yeah, if you develop something new and have programmed it and it works and you are trying to go to sell it, it takes about 3 or 4 weeks, and then they in China will copy it and produce it in mass quantities. There's no stopping that, because the very fact that it exists is already knowledge enough. Or sometimes they invite you into China to show them how you do it, and then they, 2 streets down the city, they make a factory and start to produce your thing. There's no way you can stop that. But you can do something else. You can improve it faster than they can copy it. So you make a new version, a new software update. My Apples all day are updating, and they're going mad about how much time that costs, and without any visible improvements. But it is an improvement process. So you have to be very fast in learning from your clients, somebody who copies your device hasn't have had any clients and hasn't heard what's wrong or what is good or what may be improved or what could be done with it. So it's an open effort with your clients to establish a kind of learning group. Now, how is that best done? Establish a peer-to-peer commons, they call it. A peer-to-peer commons is a place where people put more value in than they take out. Yeah, that's an open door, you can drive a lorry to that door. But like Google search, we do the searching, yeah? And they sit at the machine and collect the money. We do the work. Twitter, we enter the messages. So the population is doing the work and they provide the means and it grows because people show it to each other. So that's a nice trick to do. That's not altruism. You will see appearing sharks and dolphins. The dolphins are we are just making fun and use it, and there are some sharks who look at the money counters. Yeah? Well, ecologies have that, kinds of animals. Now, Skype, YouTube, did you see how many films are uploaded each 60 seconds? It's amazing. Instagram, Alibaba, etc., etc., etc. Those services grow because we put things in. Yeah? Even with BitTorrent, people thought they get cheap music from BitTorrent, but what they forget is that they put their computer in the network. So you get $2 or $5 for music, and you get about $200 you offer to the network, because on your computer now these things are also available. So it grows without them knowing that they put in anything. It's rather clever. Okay. Now, we will see, and this is, sorry, it's all on one sheet, but it's rather important, I think. I have to watch the time. Is the network laws. That's important for you, I think, to know. Most of you know the Sarnoff's law, which is about broadcasting, about publishing. That was mainly in America, the television networks were completely scattered in all towns, they had their own. And Mr. Sarnoff said we have to connect them into nationwide channels, you know, like NBC, etc. And he explained that the value of such a network grows by the number of eyeballs, number of people who see what's presented. So it's basically for the advertisers. It's not for the public, it's for the advertisers. They want a product to show to the public. Well, it's nothing wrong with that, but it's rather obsessive. And maybe we don't want all this, these commercials and etc. But they say, yeah, then we cannot afford these networks and blah, blah, blah. And newspapers are now panicked because people my children don't buy newspapers anymore. They say, the news I already read online, so what's a newspaper for? It's old news. So, and broadcasting is not so huge as people think. The media have enormous good advertisement system for themselves, that they are the real place where politicians should broadcast their visions and everyone. I don't look at television anymore. It's so boring. Some things, you know, on television are interesting. I heard here the next day, and then I can see them on the internet without commercials. And it's fantastic. I love it, but sitting all evening to wait for something to happen or something interesting, it's just rubbish. It's kind of sedative. Become very sleepy. Now, okay, that is broadcasting. communication is much more valuable. The value grows by the square of the number of people who join the network, because everybody can, n people can call n minus one others. Yeah? If they have something to say, it's maybe not relevant, or it's not counted, but in possibility you can call everybody on this planet with their cell phone. You can talk about the weather maybe, but it grows with n added. And there's a lot of money still in the telecommunication field. And it's about 10 times as much as in media. The content is not king. Now, the third one is less known, is Reed's Law. Professor Reed of MIT simply explained that people want to be part of a group. They want to be part of a tribe. In schools you see that you have a kind of Indian tribes on the school with their own kind of type of dress, code, language, and you either belong to the group or you are not a member. And texting was mainly used to establish that I'm still a member, yeah? I'm still belong to the group, and what are we going to do together, etc. So people can, it is very strong, that feeling that you have to be appreciated in your local tribe. And the fortunate thing is that you can now belong to more tribes at the same time. Well, 20, 30 years ago, it was impossible if you were born in a certain area, in a certain social layer. The rest of your life, you could kind of explain what would happen. You would be in that football team and then in that university or not. Or now you can in the morning be a banker, in the afternoon you can be a hang glider, in the evening you can be do something strange in town together. Yeah, there are all kinds of clubs for that. At the same time, yeah? And nobody is. So the question last night was, your family is one tribe, your work is one tribe, your hobbies are other tribes. You can be part of a Harley Davidson collectors, or collecting old computers or old Arduinos, I don't know. There's a lot of things. So these tribes have very strong bonds. But then the fourth law, which is of course, the most important, is Van Til's law. There you are. You're talking to him. Yeah? Is that if people are not only part of a group, but do something useful together, really work together and enhance things together and create and build things that work, like you do. Everybody should have one skill in which he's absolutely unbeatably good and can be relied on to produce. Yeah? That they, if you can contact those people and test them before that they can do that, you can form a team which is unbeatable. And sometimes with outside people's connected, and then you create synergy. And if all these people are unique, you can make n factorial combinations, which is of course ridiculous. This law is never going to be true, but it grows faster than exponential. That's one attribute. But if there are 10,000 people interconnected like that, 10,000 factorial, well, that is an amount which is staggeringly big, and that can never be. But my message is, if media are additive eyeballs, whether we want to look or not, we are an eyeball, we are their product. Cooperation is multiplicative. Cooperation is multiplicative. If you can find others who are absolutely good specialists in their field and they want to cooperate, the value of your group is multiplied. And that is much, much, much more stronger. Okay? And to share is to multiply. Now, this is a picture of young Dutch people watching plane land with the victims of the plane shot down over Donetsk. And it created cohesion. Suddenly our population stuck together and became one in grief. Now, that can happen also if we connect people. And I have a kind of metaphor for it, and it's called the telescope metaphor. If you have a telescope, you can look in the distance, and if you have a bigger telescope, you see more and more details, until you have such a large telescope, let's say such a large company, that the resolution is kind of over the maximum size. And it's not true. You can better connect small telescopes to each other with people, well, let's say that it is people who have different views on reality. If you connect them on internet and they can enhance each other's view, everybody gets a better image. So it's an incentive to join and very well connect and cooperate and combine things, where you get an actual size of telescope, which is the most far different points of view. So don't make the mistake that you have to want to have a tribe with everybody the same, and everybody can do this, and everybody can program, and etc. No, you need very strange, innovative people with other different, with different backgrounds, with different ideas, and then combine them. That is what's happening on the internet. We form a kind of lens together. And the trick is how to set up such a network behind all those observers to coordinate it, to copy it, to correlate. And that is where the NSA has tried, by having all these data, can they resolve it into patterns which are useful, where they can get out information. And maybe we'll talk about that a little bit later. That's where it went wrong. Their telescope was good at the front end, but in the back office, it is still failing. Now, of course, it's also the number of telescopes which gives value to the thing. Now, last couple of stories is, I have established an ID to I have found that the traffic patterns of Twitter and goods and all kinds of exchanges and things is a kind of line which runs from Ireland through the Netherlands to Germany, Austria, all the way to Istanbul, and then all the way to Shanghai. I called it Corridoria. It has to happen yet, but parts of it are. That is where there's no unemployment right now. It's very staggering. People say, hey, in the rest of Europe is in the boondocks, and this is where things are booming. That's where universities interconnect, people cooperate, join together, do all kinds of things. It's like the trade route, the Silk Route, where also culture started to be defined, which is defined most of the culture we have was done in the Middle Asia, where European, Chinese and Indian knowledge were combined. And for you, the good news is more of these trails of big cities. So not one city, but a whole trajectory. It will run through Asia, and then even kijken waar het ding was. Nou, oh yeah, here. It will. This is the corridor, yeah, and I keep the list of cities which are on it. So they, if other cities want on it, they have to pay me. Yeah, yeah, I maintain the list, right? So Paris, for instance, is not on the list. Amsterdam is not on the list. Yeah, pity for them. So it goes through Asia, then to Australia, and this is where we are right now. Yeah? So we will have a ring around, and around Africa, around America, etc. So this is rather a nuisance for state governments. They say, this is transborder. What about our jurisdiction? Yeah, I say, well, I don't know either. Yeah. Is that relevant? Yeah, for us, it's of course. Yeah. We are elected representatives. Yeah. But that is what's going to happen. So you better move to one of these city chains and start to cooperate with people from far away and add value and combine into something which the Occupy movement defined as, if you see sharks, well, we will shark you back, right? And just a final thing is, I'm very, very, very impressed with what the people in Hong Kong did. We had a kind of predecessor of it, that there was a young girl in Haren in the Netherlands who put on Facebook an invitation for her birthday to all of the Facebook. Well, the next day 10,000 people came to her village and said, where's the party? And the authorities are still trembling from how fast this was organized. Who was in charge? No, nobody. She just made a little mistake. These people, about between 50 or 100,000 people on one square, well, the government and the city said they cannot organize that. It will be a chaos. No, it's not. They used Bluetooth with fire chat, and they had it as a big chat room, and Bluetooth formed very small distance a mesh network, which is self-organizing, run anew. So the authorities cut the mobile phone, cut the internet connections, and they brought their own network. Yeah. And they organized everything. It was tightly done. There was no visible leadership. But everybody knew what was going to happen and what the idea was and why they did it. And they just waved with their mobile phones to the camera. And they created art, and they were not shot, which is something new after Tiananmen Square. Yeah? Well, I have respect for their bravery. They risked that some fool general would say, just yeah, shoot them. Yeah. What's about a couple of thousand people die? Well, it's the best of society was on that square. The young people, the young technicians, students who know better. And they had no answer to that. And it reacted so quickly that within minutes they could make decisions, and they didn't have to go to conferences or layers and layers of government. This is a kind of swarm. It's like this, like birds who fly together. They don't block, they don't run into each other. They look outside and combine what they see so they can react to things, just like fish can do. It's amazing if you, and some people say the dinosaurs are extinct. They evolved into birds, yeah. But maybe this is the new dinosaur, yeah. collectively, they are a kind of unit, a kind of being. Now, let's try to organize in the same way in society. It's not so far away. We can, we can do that. But perhaps I will tell this story at dinner, okay? And finish now. And, you play a part in something bigger, and let's swarm, okay? Thank you very much.